All right, welcome to the Fear the Fincast, the January 25th, 2017 edition in the year of our Patrick Marleau. The Sharks have won six games in a row. Marcus White, do you remember the last time the Sharks won six games in a row?
Sometime last season, probably, right?
It was definitely not sometime this season. Good work. The Sharks hadn't even won five games in a row sometime this season. I actually believe it was sometime in the playoffs that they had won six games in a row. It's a miracle, and it was spearheaded, but I actually didn't even think they won six games during the playoffs.
I don't think so either.
No. It's been a while. It's been a while, and it feels nice. Spearheaded by Patrick Marleau. So maybe it was the last time that Patrick Marleau scored, five games or five goals in over two games.
Yeah, he's never – yeah, that's – yeah, that was – he did that in the playoffs, but he's never – he's right. Never he's never done that before in a regular season, which kind of surprised me because, you know, he gets this rep for being streaky. So I was a little surprised to learn that
I thought something that was also interesting is that I did this. Patrick Marleau's now at 498 goals, only two away from 500. Something else I wanted to note is that I haven't checked this morning, but I went to check last night because there was a part of me that really wanted to pack up my car and drive to San Jose in the hopes that he'd score 500 on Thursday. Tickets were only $25 for Thursday's game against the Oilers.
Really?
I wanted to know how mediocre Sharks fans are.
Oh, interesting. My friend was asking if I wanted to go. So if they're that cheap, I'm assuming I won't get credentialed.
No, because probably not with the Oilers in town. So I would say, hey man, if you're listening right now, I would head to StubHub immediately because if the tickets are still that cheap, that's can't hurt. Yeah, still, I'm checking right now.
Oh, you really cannot go wrong there.
$25. The tickets for the Blackhawks Sharks games are also $44, which, I mean, it's not terrible if you want to hedge your bets a little bit. I would even buy those $44 tickets as well because if he gets to $499, those Hawks Sharks tickets will probably go up a lot. So – that's just a little gambling advice from me to you.
These are good seats, too.
Yeah, they are. I know. I'm pretty upset that I can't make it up there tomorrow night. So, well, I can't remember where I was going with that. Something about Patrick Marleau. Oh, yeah, right. So, his scoring rate this season, he's actually been pretty regular. This is the most streaky he's been all season. Who would have guessed scoring five goals in two games? That's pretty streaky. he's actually been pretty regular all season long. I want to go back at some point to try and look at, you know, his kind of his career arc to see, you know, how regular he is at scoring. But this season, it's been a pretty smooth pace, at least as far as scoring goals go. You know, I didn't look at his overall points because he's never been, you know, as big an assist guy as he has been a goal-scoring guy. But obviously, it's pretty exciting. Would be the first Shark to score, obviously, 500 goals with the franchise. And that's just one piece of the many pieces of big news surrounding the Sharks over the past, whatever it's been, 72 hours. It's been a really busy week in Sharks land.
Yeah, definitely. There was a trade yesterday after your smooth transition flustered me a little bit. But yes, there was a trade.
Wow, that I'm almost offended by that a little bit. Tommy Wingels got traded yesterday. Were you surprised that it took this long?
Yes and no. I think they were... I think they were probably exploring other options for as long as they could. I think they were wanting to keep giving him every opportunity, and they were going to basically make that deal. They were going to make the deal to clear cap space for Hurdle at pretty much the last possible minute. I didn't think they were ever going to trade Joel Ward. The contract is with their modified no trade. It's just going to be too hard. And I think Wingels was the natural target. We've been talking about this for seemingly
Since the offseason. I think the first time I wrote about this was during the offseason.
I think we wrote about it even last playoffs.
Probably true. Yeah.
I think, you know, it a long time coming for sure. Definitely pressed into it by the the emergence of some young players in LeBanc and Meyer who seem to have established roster spots, but also the emergence of Ryan Carpenter, I think, made that trade a lot easier because, you know, if they decide to go with Hurdle on the wing. Carpenter's played pretty well at that fourth line center spot, and they can use him there. I think long term, like we've talked about it, they ultimately have to go back to Hurdle as the third line center, of course. But yeah, a little surprised. Also, you know, a little surprised they didn't get more for Wingels. But again, I think it just shows how limited this trade market is. That, you know, the only way they could get a seventh round draft pick for a player like Tommy Wingels was to not only retain a third of his salary, but to also take two minor league contracts from Ottawa. So in essence, Ottawa is, you know, one contract less and maybe gives them a little more flexibility at the trade deadline. I also think that too could have something to do with the Sharks, you know, having so many guys up with the Barracuda, they needed reinforcements. But I think, yeah, the Wingels trade and the lack of Nieto trade really just shows everything about what this trade market is for guys who are, you know, normally we see bottom six guys like that move pretty easily around the deadline, but I have a feeling we're not going to see a whole lot of movement this year at the trade deadline because so many teams are in the same position.
Couple things worth noting. Both I'm seeing right now, both Timo Meier and Kevin LeBanc have been sent down to the AHL, I assume, to play down with the San Jose Barracuda tonight.
Whoa. Breaking news.
Yeah, on the pod.
I literally, as I just said, they established roster spots. So
I assume I look smart. The Sharks literally cannot play without them based on who they have on the roster healthy right now. So I assume they'll be back to play against the Oilers tomorrow. I was actually just on Cap Friendly. That's where I got that breaking news from. Okay. In order to take a look at one of the guys. Buddy Robinson is one of the minor leaguers they got, who I actually think is probably going to help the Barracuda out a little bit. He's about a half a point a game player in the AHL. He's only 25. I don't think he's a guy that's ever going to end up doing anything with the Sharks. I assume they'll probably try to tender him a two-way contract this offseason. I assume he'll probably take a gig somewhere else with a little more hope at maybe getting some playing time in the NHL in the future. You know, the other guy they picked up, whose name is now escaping me. That's why I went to this page, so that this wouldn't happen. Oh, yeah, Zach Stortini is a goon who I hope really never gets any play in the NHL. He's a piece of garbage who punches people in the face for money. And I believe Sharks in the face for money in the past back when he was with the Oilers. So
yes.
Yeah. And not I believe, I distinctly remember seeing Sharks punched in the face for money by this man. So I'm not really surprised because I think it's also important to remember that Tommy Wingels is getting paid nearly $3 million to score 0.22 points per game. I don't know how it happened that people set the bar for a player like that to be worth even a seventh rounder, let alone more than that. I don't know what world these people have been living in. If Doug Wilson gave up a seventh rounder for a player who's getting 0.22 points a game and is getting paid $3 million a year, I would expect people to be pretty upset about that. And so naturally people are upset when we don't get more than a seventh rounder for a player of that caliber. Listen, I really like Tommy Wingels a lot. And I think that in the past he's been a great player, but he's not a great player now. In fact, he's a pretty terrible player right now. I mean, he's a guy that, you know, had two seasons where he was, you know, what, like a half a point a game player, and that's great. Both this season and last season, he's been very, very bad and was signed to a really terrible contract by a general manager that got tricked into cow clutterbucking a little bit. And so they're lucky they got anything. This, to me, is kind of like a weird, like a almost like a waving a player, but at least we also got a pick out of the deal. So that now gives the Sharks, I believe it's 9 draft picks in this upcoming draft, which is not bad. I'm not complaining about that. That's pretty sweet. So I think this is a really good trade in the sense that I'd rather have the extra asset than the extra 30% of the, you know, cap flexibility, because I don't really think that they were going to use it anyway. So I think that's a good move.
Yeah, personally. No, for sure. I agree. Clears the space for Hurdle, allows him to return. Very surprised at this Meyer LeBanc send down, though. It's kind of throwing me a little bit here.
Right. The Barracuda play tonight.
But they played, both of them played last night.
So what?
They're going to play 4 games in 4 days.
So the Barracuda, the guys are going to sit around and drink Kool-Aid for 4 days.
No, I'm saying, so they played Monday. They played Tuesday. Right. They played play today. And then are they going to play tomorrow against Edmonton? That's 4 games in 4 days.
Yeah. They'll be fine. They're just kids.
They're probably play again on Friday for the NHL All-Star break. If it's a send down because they're like, okay, we'll send them down now and keep them down for the All-Star break, like a little odd on the timing. The Barracuda play Friday in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And then in Milwaukee.
Well, I mean, in Michigan, that's a nice short little flight. Well, they're in Stockton right now, so maybe they're not going to play on Friday then. Maybe they're just going to play in Stockton today.
Okay. Could be.
I don't know. I wasn't on the phone with Doug Wilson 2 minutes ago. Accusatory. It's a little accusatory.
Have the Sharks sent out an email confirming it?
Oh, my God. All right. I don't know. I'm going to look right now. Good Lord.
I'm just curious.
You haven't.
If not, I could do some reporting instead of email.
They have not. They have not.
Okay. I'll shoot him an email.
All right.
We don't want to get the facts wrong, Jake. That's all. We don't want to get the facts wrong.
I'm not getting any facts wrong. I'm just assuming that they're being sent down to play the Barracuda tonight.
Yeah.
Because they probably didn't. They don't. The guys haven't played all that many minutes. You got to remember that Timo Meier did even play on Monday. Did not play.
I think he played Monday. I think he came back to the lineup on Monday. But LeBanc was on the last night.
Right. I mean, and LeBanc didn't play much last night because he was stuck with the anchor Barkley Goodrow. Can we talk about Barkley Goodrow? Because don't need to see him play in the NHL ever again. I think we're good.
Yeah.
I'm fine. He's not good, man. It's like, you know what? Barkley Goodrow.
Worse than Michael Haley?
He's not worse. It's just he's not an NHL hockey player. He's just not, I don't think, really. I mean, he's not like – to me, it's not a choice between Goodrow and Michael Haley. It's a choice between Goodrow and Nikolai Goldobin or Rourke Chartier or Marcus Sorensen or Danny O'Regan. I mean, not right now. It's not because O'Regan is hurt, but you know what I mean. There are about, like, 15 guys on the Barracuda who are like, huh, Barkley Goodrow, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. I get it. That's fine. So what do we got to do to get a call-up around here, huh? What's a guy got to do? What do we got to do? I'm going to see how many voices I can do just to get that one guy pissed off to send me another tweet. Do you think he's done it already? We have a one listener who really gets upset anytime we do an alternative voice on the podcast.
Oh, yeah, I've been seeing those. I didn't think we were doing it that much, but that's probably my insular, you know, bubble-like nature of assuming that we're not doing anything too bad, but yeah, I can, in hindsight, I can see how that's a thing. the Wingels trade, unexpected, but you know, not too shocking.
I think the actual surprise, and this, I think the Sharks fans have legitimate, not beef, but the actual confusing thing, and we talked about this on the phone yesterday, is surprising that Wingels got a bigger haul than Matt Nieto. That's pretty surprising.
Yeah.
I'm sure that there's like an actual story that we'll never actually get behind why it is that happened. But that I was surprised by that. It's like, okay.
I mean, hey, he has scored more than Matt Nieto this year.
I know, but general managers aren't stupid. I mean, not all of them. Many of them, but not all of them. I mean, they're looking a little bit deeper than that, I think.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Tommy Wingels is shooting at like a career high rate and is still not scoring. So, I think general managers at least are smart enough to be like, maybe there's something going on here, guys.
Yeah.
Hey, guys, you think there's something going on here?
Yeah.
Who knows? Regardless, the big loser in all of this is obviously Tomáš Hertl, who is going to get put back on the roster to, and sees his best friend sent out of town as a result. So that's very Shakespearean. Got a feel for that guy.
Yeah.
It's been a tough year for Tomáš Hertl.
Very tough year.
Not great.
Yeah.
So the good news is, I guess, that we won't have to see Ottawa again this year. So.
Yeah. No. Unless it's the Stanley Cup Finals.
You're right. Unless it's the Stanley Cup Finals. Good call, Marcus. Thank you.
Yeah.
Out here with the fact check.
Yes.
Check, fact check. Okay, so that's that. Sharks have won 6 games in a row. They can win 7 in a row. They're in officially in first place in the Pacific Division. That's kind of exciting, huh? They've been in first place in the division in my heart and according to my charts, according to the point percentage, for the past couple of days. The Anaheim Ducks have just been stocking up on those loser points for a while. And the Sharks have now only one game in hand because they've played so many damn games in the past, whatever it's been, week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. It feels like every single day I've watched a Sharks game, which didn't used to be a complaint, and now I feel like I close my eyes and I see teal. I'm exhausted. I'm not as tired as them, but I'm pretty close to as tired as them. Pretty close. I've got aching bones everywhere. How are you feeling?
I feel great. I feel good. I feel ready to go. Rip roaring, ready to go.
Okay, that's good because I'm here on Cap Friendly and I see, oh, you just got called up to play with the Sharks tomorrow night and the Barracuda tonight and on Friday in Grand Rapids. So
yeah, that's a lot, man. That's a lot of games.
Well, it's not if you're not a giant wimp like Marcus P. White, apparently.
Hey, listen, 5 games in 5 days. That's and a cross-country flight. Yeah, that's some interesting timing, for sure. But maybe they're doing it so they're going to give Marleau all the ice time he can get tomorrow so he can try and score 2 goals before the All-Star break.
that must be what it is. Do we want to hit on Aaron Dell, who didn't play all that well last night, after we talked about how good he is?
Have we hit on Marleau?
Oh yeah, should we hit on? I've been hitting on Marleau for years. I don't know what you've been doing.
I mean Dell wasn't great, but I think
how about the goal where he like jumped out of the way of it? That he looked that like I would that was how I would play goalie. The one that I know that's not what he was actually doing. He was trying to get his shoulder in front of it. Like, right, I understand what he was actually doing, but that would be me playing goalie. Like, oh no, no, nope, nope. Mm-mm, nope.
Yeah.
I'm good. It's just one game. I'm not worried about it or anything. But I just thought it was funny that we had an article after we had talked on the podcast about him starting more. We had both tweeted about it a little excessively. I'm not complaining.
Right.
And then probably his worst game as a Shark. Of course, he's only played 2 games. So
yeah, he wasn't great. But at the same time, you know, they got that 4th goal and he was pretty money down the stretch.
Even though that last goal didn't count, I mean, I think that it was pretty close to the verge of it would have been a goal if even if Dustin Byfuglien hadn't cheated and pushed him into the net anyway. He was playing pretty crappy down there.
Yeah, I mean, but he had made some big saves.
Speaking of Muppets, he has kind of a Muppety tendency in net there. Like, if you told me there was actually somebody up in the rafters, like, whoa, pulling the strings.
I think that's more his, size. I think the biggest thing yesterday was the rebound control wasn't great. That second goal, I want to say he kicked a rebound pretty much directly to a Winnipeg Jets player, but Paul Martin was also right there and couldn't corral it.
I think he's going to generally rely on, and I don't think this is a problem. He's going to give up a lot of, and even Martin Jones gives up some rebounds. And I think that's part of that's by design, that they're going to rely on the San Jose defenders to clean up rebounds. And I don't think that's a problem because the defense is so good.
Yeah.
Right. Not necessarily a problem, but yeah, I mean, you know, it's not Carey Price out there. So
yeah,
so it is.
As a whole though, he's had a good season. So you'll take the duds, where they are. Someone who's not having
3 goals on a back-to-back after the Sharks played like a dead fish for half the game. I mean, both teams were obviously pretty tired. Then take it, right?
Yeah, if there was a game to you point at, and you're like the schedule is a little much. That was the game,
yeah,
for sure. I think he. Yeah, wasn't great last night, but, Patrick Marleau scored another goal. I keep trying to segue on it because he's 2 goals away from 500, Jake. A momentous achievement in Sharks.
500.
500 goals.
500.
A 4-goal game. I think we're both still kind of reeling from the shock of that. Like, I was at work, so I didn't get a chance to watch the whole thing. But I woke up, I'm like, oh, Marleau's got a hat trick. And then I check my phone, and I'm like, oh, Marleau scored 4 goals in one period of hockey. Playing the Avs will do that, I guess, for a player. But, you know, oh, wait, I mean, with this 5-goal explosion, you know, I think some of the thought, you know, leading into it, at least leading into these games, you know, maybe Marleau wasn't scoring as much. But I think now, I mean, now he's on pace to pretty much, like, smash what he did last year in terms of goal scoring, right? Like,
oh, yeah, not even close. His goals per game is now, like, you know, up around his 7th or 8th highest of his career.
Yeah, he scored. So he scored 25 last year. He's got 17 through 49. At the very least, he's going to top 2014-15 when he only had 19. He only had 19 goals, and you know he is definitely riding some shooter's luck this year at a 14.5% shooting percentage. But his career is 13. Career average is 13.4.
So I was going to say, he's always had a high shooting percentage because he's an elite shooter. I mean, that's just
this isn't super abnormal.
You know, he's been a double digit shooter almost every year except for last year. I think last year was the abnormally. I think
2 years before he was at 8.2.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
He has. You're right. He has been even as a rookie. He was double digits.
Yeah, that's who he is. He's a double. Yeah. He's an elite. It's like Joe Pavelski. He's an elite shooter.
Early in his career, he had back. This is a, talk about this for a 3-season stretch. 17.1%, 17.4, 16.3.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. And you know, two goals away from 500, right? That's a little surprising that we're this close, because I, you know, early in the year at the pace he was going, I was a little worried he wasn't even going to get to 500, with the pace he was going at. But now it looks like, I mean, barring stranger things have happened, but barring 2 goals in the next 33 games, he looks pretty likely to get to 500.
And even not just the way he was going, but the way the Sharks were going as a whole, you know, it just seemed like,
yeah,
somebody help Patty out here, all right? You know, yeah, somebody's going to have to grind one out and throw him an easy goal here, you know? But even beyond that, it's these past couple games, it's not even been like, oh man, hey, Patrick, I know he had a tip-in goal in that 4-goal game, but he's gone out there and just gotten them all by himself. He's looked like a man possessed, which is kind of amazing, because I don't think that that's something that at any point in his career is the way you would describe the way his game has been played. He's not really an intense player or an intense anything. Pretty smooth, but that goal, even the goal he had last night, the game winner, it seemed like everybody else was kind of frozen still, and he was the only guy out there actually trying to do anything. It was kind of amazing to watch.
Yeah, the night before, I think a lot of the goals and like his goal last night, it's just, you know, he's always been able to get in good positions. He got that was a great pass from Ryan Carpenter for his goal last night, but again, Marleau drives the net, fends off the back checking winger, and is able to tap it in. And I think he had a couple goals like that against Colorado. You're talking about a man possessed, like, you know, he's 34 years old. He's still able to use his speed and use his size to get through defenders. I just did a quick calculation, Jake, because I know how to do math. He's on pace to score 28 goals this season. Do you think he gets to 28?
I think he gets to 30.
Really?
Bold prediction. Patrick Marleau gets 30 goals this season.
So if Marleau gets to 30, that will leave him only, I believe, 3 goals away from passing Jeremy Roenick on the scoring list.
I think if that's the case, the Sharks sign him to 5-year deal and say, "Listen, you're here
and then you retire." Yeah.
And then you retire, and you know what? Let the chips fall where they may.
We'll keep the cap hit, whatever.
We'll fold the franchise. It doesn't matter. This is all that matters.
So there's been some talk now with the 500 goals that he, you know, is making a case for his Hall of Fame worthiness. I really hate these discussions on sports radio and is this guy a Hall of Famer, but I think we should do it anyway.
Okay.
I think he's definitely making a case, and I think you can make an argument for him. I think they probably need to make another. If they win a cup, I think he's in for sure. He's a lock. Like, he will get into the Hall of Fame because the voters of the Hall of Fame still love to point to the rings. I mean, isn't Chris Osgood in the Hall of Fame? Like,
he is. Yes.
Yeah. So they love to point to the rings. I think we'll see. But he keeps this up. I mean, look, he's had a great career as is. I think he's right up there in a borderline guy right now. If he wins the cup, I think he gets in. But if he doesn't win a cup, I think it'll take a lot of time because I don't think Roenick's even in the Hall of Fame.
Yet, he is right? Not. Yeah. So I did some looking at this as someone who grew up, following baseball a lot more closely than hockey. The Hockey Hall of Fame is pretty stupid. It's probably the stupidest Hall of Fame, and that's someone who follows the Baseball Hall of Fame.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you think it's stupider than baseball?
No, it is absolutely. The Baseball Hall of Fame is the best Hall of Fame by a lot, because at least the rules make sense, right? You might not agree with the rules, but it has rules, right?
Right.
Like to me, right? It's like, you know, the Big Lebowski, right? It's like, oh, this isn't the Hockey Hall of Fame. There are rules, right? You know, because like for instance, right, Dave Andrechuk has 640 fucking goals and isn't in the Hockey Hall of Fame. Would you like to know why, Marcus? There is no reason why. It's because he played for too long. Because that doesn't make any sense.
Well, that's the classic, and any New York-based listeners will appreciate this reference. That's the classic Mike Francesa argument. Oh, he's a compiler. He's not in the Hall of Fame because he's a compiler. Someone who compiles stats, who played so long that, like, they had to have gotten stats, which I don't really buy that argument because you have that long of a career.
So, and this is coming from me, from someone who literally would die if I played hockey. That's the argument of someone who never played the game.
Yeah.
You can play hockey for 25 years. You should get into the Hall of Fame if you have 0 points. Because clearly you were doing something right. Because you're A, you're not dead. B, you were good enough to play for 25 years. C, did I mention you're not dead? And D, you have 600 goals.
Yeah, How many years did Andrechuk play?
It was a lot. I mean, I'm looking. So I just have the goal list.
And did he win a cup? He won a cup with Tampa in his last year.
Yes. Yes. Oh. It's like I said. It doesn't make any sense. He played until 2006. His first season was 1982. Like, that alone to me is like something where it's like, oh,
640 divided by 25. That's still like, that's still a good career. Like that.
Right. Mark Recchi's not in the Hall of Fame, has 577 goals, right?
Oh, well, he's the classic compiler. He's the classic, like, oh, he played too long.
And this doesn't make any sense.
That's a guy who played across two different eras. Like, that's more impressive to me that he was able to continue playing and be very good after the lockout.
Or Keith Tkachuk has 538 goals. Pat Verbeek has 522 goals. Pierre Turgeon has.
Andrew's still averaging 25 goals a season. I know he played in an era when scoring was up, but like that's pretty good. Like,
So to me, it's like, okay, so that's always why I've been always kind of pretty on the fence about Patrick Marleau as a Hall of Famer, at least as far as
do you think he'll be looked at as a compiler?
Right, because he is.
Yeah,
and he's never won anything ever.
Right,
nothing, literally nothing. So it's like, I mean, and that's not me arguing his merits. That's me arguing from the position of the people who are actually going to put him into the Hall of Fame. It's like, okay,
right.
So what are they looking at here? I think that they'll like that he spent his whole career with one team because they're idiots. And I think that they'll like – That's it. That's all that they'll like. Joe Thornton has been the better player on the team since the moment he stepped into San Jose because he has. And they never won anything.
Right.
And he's an underachiever because he is. But he is. I'm sorry, like, by based on their definition of what That's what I'm saying.
Based on the Hall of Fame's definition.
Well, right. Isn't that, that's what we're doing, isn't it? Yeah. Because, like, if we're saying, here's the Hockey Hall of Fame's rules, right? You, you have to have, you know, probably have to have 500 goals if you, based on, like, the counting stats.
Right.
If you don't have a way more than that, then you probably need to have actually won something. He hasn't. You don't have any individual achievements as far as, you know, hearts or anything else.
Yep.
You should at least be the best player on your team. He's not.
Yep.
I mean, that's. I think it's going to be tough.
Yeah, it will be tough.
He's a Hall of Famer because he's got the goals. He's the best player in franchise history. He has a lot of goals, again, in an era when it's been pretty hard to score them. His longevity should help him, not hurt him, but it's going to hurt him. He's been a consistently good playoff performer, even though people say he's not.
Right.
You know, it to me, that's why I don't get – I try not to get too worked up about the Hockey Hall of Fame because it's the stupidest Hall of Fame in the world because people don't actually look at numbers and logic. They just, like, pull stuff out of their ass.
Right.
So it's a frustrating Hall of Fame. I think it's one of those things where Joe Thornton's, you know, for sure going to get into the Hall of Fame and Patrick Marleau won't, and it's going to just be one of those things. So to me – when people talk about this stuff, it's like, maybe he won't, but it doesn't really matter because I care a lot more about the jersey retirement ceremony than I care about Patrick Marleau getting into the Hall of Fame, to be honest with you.
Right.
So, when's that happening?
The jersey retirement?
Once they retire.
I was going to ask you about that because Brody Brazil tweeted last night. He thinks they're going to do they'll do them on the same night.
Yeah, I think so too. That's always been my take. Oh, God, I agree with Brody Brazil on something. Never mind. I take it back.
That'd be a fun – I think that they'll wait for both of them to retire when they retire.
I think they'll retire at the same time.
Yeah, oh, they should. I mean, they're the two. I think those two have to be the first numbers you retire.
If I – yeah, I would – how much would you pay for a ticket to go to that jersey retirement night? I'd pay a lot.
Yeah, that's like, – I mean, that'd be one –
hundreds and hundreds of dollars.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. A lot. Yeah. It'd be an emotional evening at the SAP Center. So, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, that would be my guess, would be the move. Because, yeah, that's the guys that have spent, you know, obviously Marleau's entire career and then Thornton effectively his entire career once it's all said and done. I think the one last thing we should hit on Marleau-wise is this is a question I got because I've done a couple Q&As with other SBN blogs past couple of days. It's Marleau's future with the team. And I know that there are other, you know, and I understand this perspective from the outside looking in. It's like, hey, so what's the deal? He's a, you know, a UFA. And it's not ever really been that big a concern to me for either guy because, you know, with the expansion draft coming up, it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense to extend to either guy because, you know, it's just another player you have to protect.
Uh-huh.
What's your sense for what they're going to do once the offseason rolls around?
I mean, the way he's scoring, like, it does look like 14-15 was the recent aberration. If he's still a, you know, and this is going to involve some reading between the lines a little bit, but if he's still a 20-goal scorer at this point in his career, and, you know, Pete DeBoer said yesterday, you know what you're getting with Patrick Marleau every single night. Like, Pete DeBoer actually praised Marleau's consistency, and I was like, wow, and every media member who's praised his inconsistency probably is, you know, head explode a little bit.
Well, they were already asleep on the East Coast. They weren't even paying
attention. Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah, exactly. At 4 p.m., like Pacific time, they were asleep. I'm going to nod off. What they do with Patrick Marleau, and I think this is a bit of a take, but also I think fair. It's going to say a lot about their confidence in guys like Nikolai Goldobin and Rourke Chartier and even a guy like Danny O'Regan. If they re-sign Marleau, I think they probably don't think that those guys are either ready to make the leap or in the case of Goldobin that he ever will make the leap, even though I think, you know, we've talked about it, you keep a running tally of it. You look at him statistically, he's right where he needs to be for a guy to make the jump to the NHL in terms of points per game. That being said, I think it all depends on the contract. If he wants a one-year deal, I think he's coming back. If he wants anything more than 2 years, I think they're going to be a little hesitant, and they'll try and drive down the cap hit. Maybe if they do a deal with bonuses and incentives, you know, like a 2 year, you know, $3 million a year. I honestly, I looked before the year, I thought a good comparable deal for him would be what Eric Staal just got in Minnesota, 2 years, $3.5 million per year.
Yeah, I was really surprised by how little Eric Staal got. And when I saw that, I was like, oh, okay. Well, if that's the reasonable bargain going around, then maybe it's not so crazy.
Yeah, I thought that was a good baseline for Marleau. I mean, I haven't really compared Eric Staal's stats to him, but a guy who people had talked about, oh, he's starting to decline. He isn't playing as well as he's played in years past. And, you know, Marleau, certainly the age is showing up, but the guy can still score goals. And, I mean, I think as long as he's a reliable 20-goal scorer, like, you know, and even Eric with Staal, calling up
really good year, by the way, Eric Staal has got 40 points in 40.
Yeah, that deal is looking like the best one signed this offseason.
Yeah, Minnesota's looking like a bunch of geniuses for signing that deal, by the way.
Yeah, he's also shooting 13.1%. That's 2.4% above his career average. Last year, Eric Staal shot 7.5 in New York and 6.3 in Carolina.
I'm just saying, man. I mean, like, listen, I guess that that's a little bit above his career average, but betting on, you know, a guy that, you know, I'm not saying he's a Hall of Famer or anything, but betting on a well above average player to bounce back from a, you know, bad shooting year.
Yeah.
That's what
I mean. And even a guy when he was quote unquote down was still scoring 61 points in 79 games and 54 points in 77 games.
And that's not bad.
Yeah.
NHL fans can be really hard.
He wasn't worth the contract they'd signed him to.
Which is not the same thing, man.
Agreed. And I'll say it, each of the last like 4 years, Marleau's outscored him. So maybe 3.5 might be too little. I just say with Marleau's age, that's a good comparable. Because he's gonna be on a 35 and over deal, I assume. He will be on a 35 and over deal. He's 37 right now, so he will be.
Yes. Well, Marcus, unless he's going to be getting one of those sweet
time machines.
Yeah.
I think that's a good comparable for him. I probably, if I was the Sharks, I'm not sure, you know, given their cap situation, given some other guys that are off the books, I don't know if they can afford to pay him much more than $3.5 million per year, but I mean, he seems like a guy who'd be willing to play ball to stay. I know he demanded a trade last year, but you really haven't heard those same whispers this year.
I guess we should say allegedly demanded a trade.
And I believe his wife on Twitter ranted last year about the trade demand rumors, like kind of.
Well, she said, we should acknowledge that was a rumor. And she says that never happened. I think she's full of it. I think the trade demand absolutely happened. That's my opinion.
Right.
But it does appear that that's a thing of the past.
I think a lot's changed since he made that trade
demand. I agree. Just so we're all on the same page here.
And he's got young kids. He's got a young family. He's absolutely.
Well, he got traded, they're not moving. They're stuck in San Jose for better or for worse.
So I think I could see him coming back. It's looking more likely now than
the way the dude's scoring. They have to bring him back. I think it's just a matter of what.
Yeah, no, I agree. Because how are you going to replace those 20 goals in the lineup next
year? He's second on the team in scoring.
Yeah, unless you get you get 10 from Goldobin and 10 from Danny O'Regan, you're not replacing
the Sharks. Are not the kind of organization that's going to bet on a rookie to score either, though.
Yeah. No. Agreed. Yeah. Yeah.
They're just not going
to
do
They'll bet on them to contribute, but they're not going to bet on them to score 20 goals like that. So
correct.
I can see him coming back. I've talked myself into Marleau coming back.
My guess is that they probably try to get both him and Thornton to sign identical 2 year, $3.5 or $4 million deals. That's probably my guess.
Thornton said his agent, his brother, which is awesome, that his brother's his agent, has said that he wants a 3 year deal. I think that's a negotiating posture.
His brother's also an idiot, so let's also note that. His brother's an idiot.
I just know that he's his agent. I don't know enough about him.
You've read his Twitter account, right? I mean,
I have. Yes.
Yeah.
I think he's Couture's agent as well.
We've seen Couture's brother's Twitter account too.
We have seen Johnson.
It's really a good thing that guy's not Couture's agent. I guess we can leave it at that.
I think he's looking more likely he's coming back. Looking more like
yeah I think that they'll both come back. I know that that Joe Thornton's brother drives a hard bargain, but I think that they both.
If you get them on identical 2-year, $4 million a year deals, like that's, you know, you're saving $4 million from them. That's $4 million you could give to, you know, Hurdle's new deal or Jones' new deal.
Thinking about Vlasic's new deal, the next year is also the one you got to keep in mind. Yeah.
And I mean, I think they're probably hoping that they lose a contract in the expansion draft.
They are hoping that. I think they're really hoping that Vegas takes a slightly used Paul Martin in the expansion draft instead of a slightly used David Schlemko or a slightly used Brendan Dillon. But we'll see what happens in that regard. So tomorrow's game is going to be pretty exciting. I guess we're probably hoping for too much to hope for two goals from Patrick Marleau, but he's dared us to dream.
Yeah, absolutely. These last two games he has.
Just like he's dared the other, let's see, what's the population of Aneroid, Saskatchewan? Let's find out.
I think there's like 110 people that live in Aneroid.
Well, they don't do censuses all that often in Aneroid, but he's dared all 45 people in Aneroid as of 2006 to dream. Dare to dream, Aneroid. We'll be back and do one of these again as soon as he gets to 500 goals, unless we have to do one sooner than that. I'm going to be at the All-Star game on Saturday.
That's right. So, Jake will be in L.A. for the All-Star game.
I'm in L.A. right now, so yeah. I will still be in L.A.
I mean, also the on Saturday. City of Los Angeles. I don't mean the market area.
Whoa. Easy.
don't go hurting my brand, bro. I'm in the actual city of Angels. Right now.
I am literally downtown right now.
Los Angeles doesn't have a downtown, dude. You've been there.
I was listening to the Men in Blazers yesterday, as they put it. Devo has an office in downtown LA, and he said, to get to my office in downtown LA, you actually have to leave downtown LA and then go back into downtown LA.
Right. There's several large buildings and several different clusters in the sprawl of Los Angeles.
Yes.
You know, there's no downtown in San Jose. The difference being, of course, that it's just one big sprawling suburb. In Los Angeles, it's just one large sprawl of buildings. So,
right.
Pick your sprawl. California is just one big sprawl, baby. Sprawling all over the place. Until then, is there anything else we need to hit on? Did we get everything? We're going to miss Tommy Wingels. We've got a tribute video on the website. Let's pour one out for Tomas Hurdle. Is he old enough to drink yet?
Yes, he is.
Good for him.
I think something I want to touch on too about Wingels' legacy. I tweeted about it yesterday, but you know, I think it's kind of been lost because I don't know if he still has involvement in the organization, but he had some very critical early involvement with the You Can Play project, which is an important cause trying to end homophobia in sports. You know, we've seen guys on the Sharks participate in ads for that. Joe Thornton did. Wingels did. Read an article. Yes, reread David Pollock's great article about it from, you know, when Wingels was a rookie. That was a cause he was passionate about because he went to Miami of Ohio where Brendan Burke was a manager before he passed away. It's a good cause, and it's good that he was, you know, he participated in that. And I honestly, you know, more so than anything, his more than his on-ice legacy, I think those contributions are important and will be remembered and should be remembered. I mean, Patrick Burke in this article literally said that Wingels wrote one of the first two checks the organization got to get them off the ground. So, you know, he's a good guy. Always enjoyed talking to him when I did get the chance to talk to him at Sharks practices. He gave great answers. So, yeah.
I think it's worth noting that, they don't get any involvement from anyone else in the Sharks organization if Tommy Wingels doesn't get it off the ground, which isn't a criticism necessarily of anyone else in the organization, but he was definitely the guy that that got that going. So it's something he's definitely, I believe he's still involved in. I know when they've done, when the organization has done charity events in the area, he's still the guy that, you know, that spearheads it in the area, the whatever charter member, I guess, if you will. So
yes,
I assume that legacy is going to continue in Ottawa and wherever else he ends up, you know, after this season.
Maybe he ends up in hometown Chicago.
Please don't say that. Anywhere but Chicago.
You know it's gonna happen. He'll be cheap this year. They're gonna need some cheap depth. Like, and then he's gonna score like 15 right. goals.
Play. All right, that's enough. That's enough. It's been a rough week. Please just shut up. You're the worst. All right. Until next time, I'm gonna fire Marcus White after this show.
This is my last podcast.
Yeah, and then I'm gonna kill him. I'm Jake Sundstrom. You can follow me on Twitter at Jake Sundstrom. Go tweet hate speech to Marcus P. White at Marcus P. White.
Please don't. There's enough of that in the world.
And by hate speech, I mean something really, really positive about the Phantom Menace in his Twitter. Jar Jar Binks gifts for the next 24 hours at Marcus P. White.
DDoS attack of Jar Jar gifs.
That's a good idea. See if we can shut his email down or something. And you can follow us at Fear the Fin. It is. What day did we say it was? January 25th? Unless we get one of those time machines, Patrick Marleau's eyeing. Hey, can we mention real quick, by the way?
Yes.
The best part. There's two best parts. Obviously, Patrick Marleau scoring 4 goals is great. My favorite part, for sure, is his wife, Christy Marleau.
Calling it a dick trick?
Not just on Twitter, but...
But on the phone, yes.
On the phone, first thing she said... Yeah. To Patrick Marleau. What shade do you think Patrick Marleau's face was when she said that?
Oh, he turned bright red. Bright.
Bright.
Red Wings jersey red.
I hope Joe Thornton was there, because I'm sure nobody enjoyed this.
I didn't even think that when I saw the 4 goals thing. And then everybody was like, oh, man, only Joe Thornton had him. I'm like, oh, man. And then, Couture says, stroke it, Patty, when he tweeted that game. Burns is tweeting rooster emojis. Like, I'm glad that's persisted, and we've capitalized with an excellent shirt at
fearthefin.com. Yeah, at fearthefin.com. Support our capitalism. I'm sure that is the only thing that was talked about in the locker room after the game.
Oh, no doubt. No doubt.
And I really do believe that nobody has enjoyed this more than Joe Thornton. Just nobody in the world.
I feel like there were some jokes tweeted when Thornton made that comment. Somebody made a joke about what Marleau would do if he scored 4 goals in a game. That he didn't actually say. It was just something very awkward. I can't remember what it was, but like...
I seem to remember the neutral tweeting some stuff about what what Patrick Marleau would do. And now, I bet there's some stuff on the Fear the Fin account
we should dig through the Fear
the Fin. We should dig through the archives. You're right. There's probably some good stuff in there that I can take credit for. That's a good idea. You're right. I can take credit for
it. Okay,
well.
Sorry, Derek.
Yeah, sorry. Until such time, we'll be back with another podcast. Maybe on Monday after the post All-Star break, if I make it back from Los Angeles alive. What do you think?
Sweet.
All right. Sweet. Okay. Later, guys.